Traumatic issues in Nigeria during the Biafran War, and then she migrates over into the UK. But because of such a traumatic experience she's had within Nigeria, when she comes to the UK, she wants to totally forget about where she's coming from. Then eventually she ends up getting married and having kids within the UK here. But the problem is with her, because she's had so much issues from where she's coming from, and she wants to dissociate herself from her culture, she doesn't raise her kids within that culture. But because the culture, she's grown up in it and it's instilled within her, she can't help but not not react in certain ways in which she was brought up. But she has kids here within the UK who is brought up within the Western culture. So there's a misunderstanding because they don't really understand where mommy's coming from. Why mommy say we shouldn't do this, we shouldn't do that, because I don't understand. My friend does it. My mum's friend allows me to do it. My best friends allows them to do it. So why can't I? Why do you restrict me in some certain ways? But she restricts them in certain ways because of her culture, where she's coming from. But because she's not raised her kids in that culture, there is misunderstanding, especially between the mother and the daughter. The daughter does not understand. And this ultimately affects and destroys their relationship completely. So literally, acceptance is based on a family drama whereby an ordinary girl, which is the daughter, is betrayed by the people she loves, such as her mother and her husband. And we see the ultimate betrayal and the destruction which it causes within the family. And acceptance can be bought on Amazon and completely knowable, and is available on Waterstones and OkanaBooks.com. Sorry, my publicist is... Sorry about that. Acceptance has actually been adapted into a movie, which is part one of this book. And right now, it has been changed to a screenplay, and we're hoping releasing the film next year. At the moment, we're looking for further investors and sponsors to come on board to make this dream a reality. Thank you.
We're talking about culture and identity, and where I'll start you off with is a quote by an eminent professor in the States called Dr. Erica Annie, and she says that culture is like your immune system. I'll tell you why this is relevant as I finish what I have to say. I'm one of the directors for this film, Ancestral Voices, Esoteric African Knowledge, which deals with the topic of African spiritual philosophy. Yes, because all too often we have Africans who are willing to discard the way of their ancestors and buy into what is essentially a colonial hangover. Yes, what they've told us is evil or witchcraft or devil worship, whatever you want to call it. Yes, but then let's look back at some of them, whether these claims actually stand true. The Dogon, a tribe in the area we now call Mali, has among their spiritual cosmology, you know, they have symbols and signs. And one of the signs that they found, which again, remember this is meant to fall under witchcraft, they found these symbols which A, represent what we now call the atom, we tend to find is the makeup, which we now find is the makeup of the human body. The other thing they were able to do were to chart astrological maps by
obviously they don't have telescopes or microscopes or these big things that we use to chart the stars now. And what we come to find is now NASA have identified most of the constellations that they seem to draw with their human eyes, which we can only find now because we're using machines. One of these stars is named Sirius 2. You can do the research on it and find out for yourself. The next thing we can look at is, in Africa, we have some communities which go along the matrilineal line. Yes, so whereby marriages are determined by your mother's lineage. Again, if this was supposed to be witchcraft or devil worship, we come to find that it was only until the Crimean War, someone mentioned in Mary Seacole, when Europeans discovered that human beings had particular blood attributes. Yes? And because during the war, when they tried to transfuse blood, it wouldn't work. So the matrilineal aspect of even arranging the society had a function because it created genetic diversity. We know this to be true because among the Jewish communities and the Pakistanis especially, where they end up marrying random cousins, there's a lot of genetic mutations. These are things Africans knew before the advent of modernity or all these machines. Yet, we're still willing to call it backward and primitive. Let's bring it closer to home, to Uganda. In the early 1800s, there was an English explorer by the name of R.W. Felkin, and he identified a group of people in the place we now call Uganda who were performing cesarean operations successfully at a time when Europeans had almost 100% death rate from cesarean operations. But guess what? Where do we now find as the centers of medicine for cesareans? It's not only in Uganda, it's now here. So the question we need to ask ourselves is, how did the teacher become the student? Yes? Because we are discarding these traditions. So what my work does, and I'll urge all of us to do, we need to go back and re-examine these ways for useful aspects. Because obviously not everything is 100%, should we say, correct or positive, but where we can find use, let's examine it for what it is. Let's form our own opinions. That's what identity is about, is it not, young mayor? Yes, your identity, it has to do with you, your own agency as well. So rather than accepting all these imperialistic notions as 100% correct, let's now go back and do our own research. Let's speak to our elders. Let's speak to our ancestors. Let's find the right guidance. So closing off, going back to that quote, culture being your immune system, we've just seen Africans discarding these traditions. Can you see how we're behaving? Our immune system is weak. We're acting like we're here. We're not contributing anything of value now to the rest of humanity. So thank you all very much for listening. We're trying to make a part two to the film. So if you Google Ancestral Voices into Google, YouTube, you'll find most of our clips. If you feel what we're doing is worth your while, kindly help us by either donating or sharing on our works to others. Thank you and enjoy the rest of the evening.
By my stage name, Jenna. So I'm a Ugandan artist. I grew up here, but I always, because of my passion of where I come from, I've always ensured that I represented my culture through my music, regardless of the influences that were around me. That's me.
Hello everyone, my name is Lisa Koblix. I am representing the Luo Culture Group with my group today. And I'm really happy to be here and happy to have been invited. Thank you.
Good evening everybody, my name is Yahya Chibald. I was born in Uganda. I speak both English and Ugandan very fluently, despite the word, believe it or not. And I'm running for parliament at the moment in Cameroon.
Well, hello everyone, my name is Caroline. I'm the leader of the Youth Forum, Uganda Youth Forum. I am African, I am Ugandan, and my profession is I'm a psychologist. So please, please enjoy this moment, engage with your identity and culture as we start.
Hello Hello everyone, and my name is Cleopatra. Sorry. Well, I'm Cleopatra and I'm moderating today. That's it. Thank you. Okay, we're going to move on and go to the questions that we're going to ask the panel, okay? One of the questions is, what is cultural capital? Who would like to answer that?
Thank you very much. Cultural capital has been defined into three main subtitles. You have embodied, you have linguistic, and you have objectified cultural capital. For the sake of time, I'll focus primarily on institutionalized cultural capital. This plays a concept in many cultures and societies within the UK today, and you find that this concept is based basically to do with businesses and industries and how different groups are able to put their cultural capital towards economic power. For example, in a place such as Chinatown, you have the setup there, you find that the seller, 9 out of 10 times, is from China, and the buyer, also 9 out of 10 times, is from China. And the seller in that particular society sells a particular commodity or a particular resource that the buyer is interested in, and it usually comes from their country of origin or their place of origin. And we in the Ugandan community can use this as a blueprint, especially to push us forward and to push our economic status forward. It's something that a doctor called Dr. Claude Anderson of the Institute of Harvard called as power economics. And I believe once we use this as a blueprint, it can definitely push us forward as a people. Thank you very much.
It's giving most of the information, but just in simple terms, to me, cultural capital is anything which promotes our country inside and outside the country. Could be beans, coffee, music, anything which promotes our culture outside the country. To me, that's cultural capital.
Would you guys like to contribute to that? I'll go last.
Okay, I'll say cultural capital is plainly non-financial social assets.
For me, cultural capital is all the things that you learn growing up, the things that you get from your surroundings, from the context that you grew up in, that help you get along in society, the society that you grew up in. For example, one example of cultural capital is learning to speak, adjust the way you speak towards different audiences. That's for me, that's one major cultural capital that you all have to get.
Fantastic. Cultural capital, simply said, is you. You are the cultural capital. You are an asset to your culture. You represent your culture. You represent your identity. Right? Cultural capital is simply, as my learned friend said, language. Language is important. English language is a cultural capital because it's known wide world. You know, these are the tools that we use internationally. Now, when you come with African languages, they're known in Africa. But when you go to Africa, you get the English language. Now, whose capital are we using? Your capital or the English capital? So, cultural capital is used how you engage with different people. Cultural capital is the language that we just spoke about. Now, when you go to a workplace, they ask you, do you speak another language? So they can use you as a commodity to exchange, you know, translations of anything that they do within that culture organization. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that. And so the next question, can tribal segregation affect identity? Who's burning to answer that question?
With our parents, there's a lot of tribal segregation in that way, but I think positive things is that whenever I meet a Ugandan, my first thought is like, they have to be a Chuli. My first school is Omokodro, Ugandan. And then we kind of go on to talk about where we're from, where our parents are from, and it's positive dialogue rather than kind of carrying on negative things that from former conflicts that our parents might have had back home. I think moving forward, within the UK, we can positively move forward together. Like platforms like this, we're from different tribes throughout Uganda, whether you was born there or here, I think there needs to be a positive mind frame that we're all Ugandans, and to move forward positively, we need to unite. Thank you.
Your name is Atieno. If you didn't know, now you know. I'm a Kenyan. How many Nigerians are here? Now, Nigerians, I'm warning you, I'm a Kenyan. Please stop claiming me. Do you know what? I've listened to the topic about culture and identity, and I've soaked it all in. I was obviously born in Kenya. I came to the UK 19 going to 20. And obviously when I came here as well, it was a bit of a culture shock. Not because I didn't know about their culture, but because all the images I saw about Africa were so negative. Images that I never saw 19 years growing in Africa. Carrying on with my life. I was born in the city, but I spent a lot of time in the village with my grandfather to London from Birmingham on the Virgin Trains. I was listening, I like listening to conversations on the train. So there was a family, a British family, and one of the boys, I think 8 years old, because my daughter is 9, so I can gauge the age. So the boy said to the mum, well, you know, I'm British. And he stressed that he's British. And the mum said, well, I can't really agree with you on that because you were born in Cyprus. I was pregnant at the time. I gave birth to you in Cyprus and then I came back when you were 1 year old. But you will know what? The boy is adamant, he's British. So if you were born in Africa, and you came here at the age of 3 or 1, or your parents are from Africa, you are African. Come on. That boy declared he's British, even though his mom is telling you.